Welcome to the broadcast. Tonight, Steve Forbes looks back at the campaign he ran and forward to the campaign Bob Dole must run.
There was a vacuum there of lacking of growth and opportunity. That's why I got in the race. It was all austerity, all like accountants who saw just numbers and not people. And how did somebody with my background, lack of political experience, come close to derailing Bob Dole, winning primaries, nearly became the nominee?
Novelist Dominick Dunne on O.J. Simpson, The Trial of the Century.
Johnny Cochran would say to Judge Ito, Your Honor, this trial is a search for truth.
Who would say that?
Johnny Cochran. He said it every day. Your Honor, this trial is a search for truth. And then he'd go on and tell us that while the murder was taking place, O.J. was chipping golf clubs, and the Colombian drug gang over here was killing Nicole because they thought she was Faye Resnick. I mean, it was absurd what he was saying.
Finally, the Motley Fools, David and Tom Gardner, with business advice on the Internet.
This particular medium is two-way. It's the first interactive medium. And so people have the opportunity, if they, let's say, read our book and don't understand something, they can come right online and ask us a question. And so there's this incredible conversation that's developed, in this case, about the stock market.
Steve Forbes, Nick Dunne, and the Motley Fools when we continue.
Charlie Rose is made possible by a grant from USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
From the Midtown studios of Bloomberg Television in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
Many influential observers agree that the Dole campaign has not yet found its voice. Now the prospect of a fight over abortion and other issues threatens to further hobble the Republican campaign. The Republican establishment is in what Newt Gingrich described as a funk, fearful that they may lose the gains made in Congress in the last election. We continue our coverage of the Dole campaign tonight with Steve Forbes. As a candidate for the Republican presidential nomination, he won primaries in Arizona and Delaware and forced the rest of the field to present their own versions of the flat tax. He won a key Republican endorsement in Jack Kemp, and I am pleased to have him on this broadcast. The last time he was here was before he announced, so we have a lot of ground to cover. Welcome back.
Nice to be back.
Bob Dole beat you, and he beat Pat Buchanan, and he beat Lamar Alexander, and he beat Phil Gramm, and he beat others. What's wrong with his campaign now? Why is the qualities that he won the primaries so successfully not reflected in where he stands as a candidate in the general election?
Well, one thing you discover with politics is that because you've done something in one contest, doesn't like baking bread each day. You have to bake the new bread each day. Last week's isn't going to do it. And in the early contest, he got in very serious trouble. The first half dozen contests he lost or was humiliated in every one. It was only in the later primaries that he got it together, that he started to get some themes out there. Since the end of the campaign, I think that people are looking now for a true pro-growth, pro-hope agenda, and that's what they're waiting for. He hasn't come forth with it yet, and this ties into what you touched on earlier about the funk with the House Republicans, who had been a font of ideas. One of the mistakes they made during the fall in the budget battle with Bill Clinton was they didn't remind the voters that all of these proposals are means to an end to improve people's chances to get ahead in America. And instead, they came across as accountants more interested in numbers than people, and they concentrated, we must get the budget in order, but that's not the way to real growth. A balanced budget will come if you make some of these other reforms. You'll get the political capital to make those difficult long-term changes. But people must see that you're making proposals that will improve their lives immediately. They know we can do better. The energy when you go around this country is there. People can't feel, they can't get a handle on what's wrong, why we're not doing better. We sort of have walking pneumonia. And so I think their instincts are right. We can make some immediate changes to improve things in this country.
Do you think Bob Dole understands that in his gut as well as in his brain?
I think he's enough of a political animal, so to speak, that when he's out there, he picks it up, and he's accustomed to picking up vibrations from people who are either petitioning him in the Senate or out in an audience. So in that sense, I think he will pick it up. And I think we have to remind ourselves before we write his obituary that this is April, May. It's not August before the convention. It's not October on the eve of the election. There is time to put it together. I think the House leadership, I visited with them a few days ago, they're getting out of their funk. They're coming up with some imaginative ideas on tax changes. And I think the same thing is going to happen with the Dole campaign.
So you were saying to Speaker Gingrich, while he said Republican Party's in a funk, you're saying the House leadership seems to be in a funk themselves.
They were, and they're pulling out of it. The leadership has pulled out of it. I think in the
What's
next
the
few
evidence
weeks,
of that?
The ideas that they're banding about inside on constructive alternatives of minimum wage, such as liberalizing the earned income tax credit to give people with low incomes, with dependents, enable them to have more, keep more of what they earn, be able to get a larger credit, changes in the payroll tax, other such changes that would go a long ways to enabling people who are struggling to have a better chance to get ahead.
Bob Dole doing the right thing on the minimum wage?
I think they will in the next few weeks. Up to now, they were very defensive, and they allowed the Democrats to portray the issue as one of helping people struggling to get ahead and glossing over the fact that every time you raise it, you destroy jobs. There is ways, through things like the earned income tax credit, to enable people with low incomes to have more, to get out of the welfare trap or avoid going into the welfare trap, especially people with dependents. A lot of people at the minimum wage are part-time workers, a lot of teenagers. What you want to do is help those people who have dependents, who really do have to support a family. They're the ones who really need the help, and there are ways to do it without destroying jobs. And so I think there are a lot of exciting ideas beginning to brew up again, whether medical savings accounts, instead of Medicare, for example. They got in the swamp of trying to determine
budget battle.
Yeah, trying to determine co-pays and things in the year 2002. There are better ways to do it.
Many people will say that Bill Clinton is ahead in the polls today for two reasons, M-square and E-square. M-square is Medicare and Medicaid, and E-square is education and the environment, that he has co-opted those issues, and that has given him a 15% a 15% margin in the polls. You buy that?
Well, people do want change, but they don't want it done in a way where you're sort of a zero-sum game, where you're destroying people, throwing widows and orphans in the snow. They know we can make changes without throwing people out of the wagon, so to speak, or disrupting
we
a lot of lives.
Sound like Bill Graham there.
in fact, I had fun that he would say in the campaign, this, I think, gets to the grimness sometimes of the Republicans, he said, I want more people out of the wagon pulling the wagon. I responded to that the genius of the American people were that we invented engines and tractors to pull wagons. We didn't need people to pull wagons. But there are ways to help people have a chance to get ahead instead of coming across as people who are trying to take something away. In short, if we give resources, allow the American people to keep more of the resources they make, they will create more resources, whether it's John Kennedy's way, Ronald Reagan's way. We've done it before, and I think there's some exciting ideas to do it again.
In terms of tax cuts that they made?
Tax cuts, Social Security, Medicare, parental control of education. There are a lot of good experimental schools in cities like Milwaukee where you have real choice. Parents are in charge. They got away from the bureaucracy. Kids are starting to get a real education.
How many meetings have you had with Senator Dole since he won the primaries?
When I ended my campaign, I had a very cordial conversation with him.
How long?
Oh, it was a few minutes.
A few minutes.
But I have had conversations with the people who are running his campaign.
Yeah, come on. Well, I mean, come on. I mean, you
on,
here.
I bashed him for 6 months.
Yeah.
And I think the way I could have a meeting with him, it would be, I'm sure, very formal. He would be very polite. I'd be on my best behavior. But if you want to get ideas through, you just don't do it one-on-one. You talk to the people around him. You talk to the people on the Hill. You talk directly to the voters.
It's starting to
make a
difference.
Well,
but just help me understand here. I mean, okay. This is not gotcha journalism. There is some distance between you because of the harshness of your attacks on him during the primary campaign.
We're not personal. They pointed out the fact that he had a record of raising taxes.
We talked about that during the campaign, and raising
spending.
His perception is what's at issue. He feels like that you did serious damage to him in the primary campaign, and that part of the reason that he's doing so badly in the polls today is the attacks that you inflicted on him in the primary campaign, especially in Iowa and New Hampshire.
Well, Iowa and New Hampshire, if you look at national polls, which we're looking at today, Iowa and New Hampshire are about 2% of the nation's population. The early primaries were about 10% of the nation's population.
But that's not the issue, as you know. The issue is the perception in terms of the media. All the television programs where they were running your ads across the country, and he was having to respond to them.
But what did I say in those ads that he couldn't easily counteract? I pointed out that in the past, he had been a major booster of taxes. He had been a major booster of spending increases. He could have easily have turned that around, can easily turn it around today.
How could he have turned it around?
He could have said, I've been in Washington. I've seen what works, and I've seen what doesn't work. I've seen, made my mistakes. I've made done good things, and I've made mistakes. I know what can get America moving again, and unlike Steve Forbes, I know how to get it done. That would have been the end of it. If he had adopted that pro-growth agenda in September, my campaign would have ended, I probably wouldn't have even announced.
Oh, do you think it's that simple that he could basically have said what you just said, and if he'd given that speech enough times, you would not have been a factor?
Sure, because there was a vacuum there of lacking of growth and opportunity. That's why I got in the race. It was all austerity, all like accountants who saw just numbers and not people. And how did somebody with my background, lack of political experience, come nearly to, in January, come close to derailing Bob Dole, winning primaries, nearly became the nominee?
Answer your own question.
How did it happen? Because of the power, my message of growth and opportunity. But there's no patents in politics, no copyrights. Others could have done it, but there was a vacuum.
And
I saw the vacuum.
And you expect that, in fact, not Bob Dole, but Bill Clinton will be the person who adopts that idea. Not the flat tax, but pro-growth and talking in terms of economic growth the way you talked in the campaign, don't you?
That is a possibility, and that's why it's essential. That's why it's essential that the Republicans get out their pro-growth agenda. They've been discussing, proposing these ideas. Dick Armey, the House Republican majority leader, has been doing it for years. My flat tax is simply a variation of his, and I think if the Republicans do that, Senator Dole does that, they will have more credibility at the end of the day than Bill Clinton. People may like him personally, but I think people realize there's not a core there, that he can say one thing one week, mean it very sincerely, and then the next week say the opposite thing and mean it very sincerely and not even remember that he'd said the opposite thing the week before.
Right. Let me just revisit this idea that Gingrich and Bill Kristol and Bill Bennett and others have discussed, that somehow the Dole campaign can't get started, can't incorporate these ideas, doesn't have a message. What do you think is at the heart of the problems that Republicans are speaking to about that campaign?
Well, I think, first of all, as I said, we're April, May. It's a little early to be writing definitive obituaries.
Well, I read a story today in the New York Times, and there was a story in the New York Times, I think, but it basically was about this quick mechanism strategy of the Clinton people and how they think that if they just hang in there and push, they'll create such a margin that by the end of the second convention, it'll be too late to change it.
It's never too late. In 1996, I mean, every election is volatile. George Bush was 17 points behind Dukakis in 88. He was 12 points ahead of Clinton in June of 1992. These things change, especially in an environment where people recognize America is at a crossroads. The political landscape is changing. There is no consensus, and they're looking for leadership. They're looking for proposals to get this country moving the way we know it should. Our growth is pathetic. It's the slowest expansion we've had. The fundamentals are there for us to do significantly better. And so somebody who comes across with credibility, not verbiage, but credibility, and Bob Dole, if he adopts that agenda, as I think he will, the fact that he is not glib and articulate will stand as a stark and, I think, convincing contrast to somebody who is very free with words, but look at his actual performance.
Well, without talking about your glibness or articulateness, do you think that worked for you because of the way you campaigned and you had a sure understanding of what you believed in? but you were not as smooth on the platform as Bill Clinton has been. In his, that it worked for you because it gave you authenticity?
I think that the voters sense very quickly, does this person have a sense of where the country's at, where the country's going, what our problems are, what our opportunities are, and whether you're speaking from the heart or whether you're speaking off a teleprompter. And that's why these in these early primary states, these Q&As you have, whether it's at the Rotary Club or coffee clutches or the like, where they can ask you directly questions, not through an intermediary, they can sense, does this person have a sense of where he's coming from or where the country can go?
Whether he's reading it from a cue card.
And the fact that at the time that my campaign was starting to pick up some steam, making some moving forward, was at the time that many political reporters were saying, this guy doesn't know how to smile right. He's a rich boy. He doesn't do the things that politicians should do. He's awkward. He's not doing the things he should do in these early states. Voters, give him credit, can see through that stuff. And they want, certainly this time, they want substance. And that's how we got as far as we did.
How significant are paid commercials to political success?
It is, I think, essential, because it's a way to get your message across without somebody filtering it or saying, I don't agree with it or I agree with it. You look at my flat tax commercials, and you look at how it was reported in the media, and it was day and night. I never could have gotten that message across without having those commercials. It was the only way to talk directly. There are other ways, aside from one-on-one talk shows, radio shows, and the like. Well, that was the way you could get your message out there. And otherwise, people would not have known. You look at some of these news reports. They made it sound like my flat tax, 17%, was on all of your income. They left out the fact that a family of four paid no tax on their first $36,000. A governor of one of those early states baldly misstated my flat tax position.
We're talking about the governor of New Hampshire.
See
there, I mean, there you are becoming like a politician. I mean, it was obvious.
No, I'm trying to be charitable now that it's over. I hit him hard when I was in New Hampshire.
As tough as I saw you get was when you felt like he had misstated your record with respect to that,
yeah,
and came forward and said that. So many people come to this table, and it really is, and consultants, candidates, policy advisors, and they'll sit and they'll talk to me about a particular candidate or a particular position. The camera will go off and they'll go in the other room and we'll sit and talk as the conversation continues when our allotted time is up. And what they say about a particular candidate is quite different from what they've just said, because they want to be generous, because they don't want to sort of raise the white flag of surrender. My question out of that is that if you and I walk out of here, are you going to have a much tougher assessment of where you think the Dole campaign is than you articulate in the minutes that we've spent together so far?
No, I think what they have to do to win is very basic, have this pro-growth, pro-hope agenda.
And that will do it?
That's the only way to do it. If you don't have substance to offer to the American people on how to get the country moving, what kind of nation we can be, what our role should be overseas, how we provide genuine opportunity here at home, turning the word opportunity from a word of rhetoric to a descriptive word, which it isn't for millions of Americans today. If you don't put that kind of agenda on the table, there's no way he can win. He'll never be able to pucker his lip the way Bill Clinton can. Bill Clinton on the superficialities does very well. The only way he can beat him is on substance.
What do you think of Bill Clinton?
I think that I admire, or respect, I should say, his political skills, the way he bounces back from seemingly impossible situations. But I'll say this on the air, what I'd say to you off the air, the man lacks a core. I think the voters sense that. There is not a core there.
No core. No core beliefs, no core character, no core what?
There's no inner compass. And that's why he can, with equal sincerity, say the opposite things each day. He's a man, to be blunt, who has to get up each day, look at the polls to find out what he's supposed to believe that day. And that's not what the country needs right now. It needs truly the vision thing.
Every president since Eisenhower who's been above 50% in approval at the time of the National Convention has gone on to win re-election.
This is the wonderful thing about America, is that precedent doesn't always hold. We're always breaking the rules. Whether it's Truman being behind in the polls in 48, Bush being behind in 88, Bush looking invincible in 92, an outsider like me coming along, an Arkansas governor coming along, we don't let the past determine our future.
Is abortion going to be a real problem for Senator Dole at the convention?
Not if he says the platform is a goal, and there are various ways of reaching that goal. I don't think they'll have a fight about it, but I don't think it's going to be an issue that's going to destroy or split the party.
What should he say? What he should say, that the platform is only a goal that reflects the diversity of our party and
well,
and
what he
on?
Should say is what I tried to get across in the primaries is that the platform is a goal, but to achieve a goal in a democracy, you have to persuade people. That's one-on-one. Right now, the polls are right in the sense that there is not even probably a majority that would be willing to ban abortions for the whole pregnancy. There is a consensus that you can reach today, I think, on banning it for late pregnancies, barring a life-threatening emergency. That would ban it for purposes of sex selection of the baby, mandatory government funding, and certainly support for parental notification
all
in the case of minors.
Would
I would support. And I would support, I want abortions to go. But I took the approach that we have to take it step by step. If you want to change the law,
change the culture.
You have to change the culture. But to change the culture, you try to change the law little by little. We don't want a repeat of prohibition. It has to come from the heart. I think there will be a change in America, but you have to use persuasion. No shortcuts in the democracy.
You seem then to stand with Governor Whitman, Governor Wilson, and Governor Pataki.
Not on the issue. They, as I understand it,
for example,
they're pro-choice.
But
I want abortions to go. I think my approach is the way to make progress on the issue. If you make progress in one area, then you can perhaps persuade people to take the next step, one step at a time. I don't want this deadlock to go on for another 23 years. Governor Weld, for example, on the issue of, for example, of partial birth abortions, supports the president's veto. I found it appalling.
The Christian Coalition and its influence in the Republican Party, how significant?
I think the thing that you learn very quickly when you go with the voters is that voters vote as individuals. They join organizations because they have shared purposes and goals, but they don't take dictation from above. You really do have to go and persuade them. In Iowa, some social conservative leaders attacked me, and it hurt. I then engaged in dialogues.
You had a meeting with them.
Not just with the leaders, but also in states like New Hampshire and elsewhere, directly with the voters, where they could ask me questions. I could talk to them directly. And in states like Arizona, I got a good percent of that vote because people could hear me speak and they made their own minds up.
Steve Forbes ran for president in 1996 and may run for president again, runs Forbes magazine, which is a full-time job in itself. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. Dominick Dunne is here. We'll talk about his work. Stay with us. Dominick Dunne is this century's preeminent chronicle of America's rich, famous, and fallen. As a writer for Vanity Fair, he has covered Klaus von Bülow, William Kennedy Smith, and the Menendez brothers. He was a fixture at the Simpson trial beside the family of Ron Goldman. He is a best-selling author. His novels mirror real-life dramas and look behind the facade of high society. His fifth novel, A Season in Purgatory, is the subject of an upcoming television series, and I am pleased to have him here anytime, and especially now. Welcome back.
Charlie.
Great to see you.
Great to see
you. Let me just run through these, sir. Tell me guilty or innocent, or did they do, not guilty of innocent, because you always get the question of what a jury said is final. Do you think they did what charged? Klaus von Bülow.
Klaus von Bülow. Well, yes.
William Kennedy Smith.
Yes.
Menendez brothers admitted.
Well, we know that.
O.J. Simpson.
Of course.
What is it about?
I'm not sure. You know, I just want to qualify a little bit on Klaus. I think he certainly didn't want her alive, let me put it that way. And he didn't call for help for Sonny. Whether he actually administered something that killed her, that I must say, I do not know that. I do not have a
feeling.
Whether
he injected with insulin or whatever it was.
Yeah.
Do you think Alan Dershowitz knows?
I think they all know.
They do.
It is absolutely my feeling. You know, I knew a guy during the trial, I still know him, and
Von Bulow?
No, I'm talking about O.J. Simpson,
right.
And who was very in with the defense team, very, very close to them. And one day I said to him, how many of them know? And he said, oh, they all know, but they never talk about it. And, you know, I believe that.
Barry Sheck has been here a number of times with me.
Yeah.
He kind of adopts an agnostic quality about it.
He's a very interesting man, Barry Sheck. In the first place, I think he was by far the best lawyer on the defense team. I think he's a brilliant, brilliant lawyer.
That means he was the best lawyer in the courtroom.
Correct. Correct. I don't feel the same about his partner, Neufeld, but I do about Barry. And he's a brilliant man. And once he revealed something to me about himself in a private moment, in which I felt that there was a soul in there, that there was perhaps a troubled conscience within, it changed my whole relationship with him. What happens, you know, when you're in a room, the same room, with the same people for a year, you know, you all get to know each other. And we all knew each other in that, those of us who were the regulars in the room. And whether, you know, I'm outspoken in how I feel, but it doesn't keep the defense from coming and talking to me. I never chase after them, but it's just amazing to me how often the defense.
And Barry Sheck wanted to talk to you.
Yeah.
About what?
Well, it was about his feelings about the Goldman family. You know, I became very close to the Goldmans, and Judge Ito seated me next to them. And I wasn't picked from the lottery for my seat. I was assigned a seat by Judge Ito. And he said to me, you know, I think that you would be sensitive to the feelings of the Goldman family. And what he was referring to was the fact that I, too, had lost a child in a homicide case. Is that what we're talking about, the Goldmans?
Sure.
Yeah, well, I mean...
Well, we're talking about lawyers and whether Sheck showed you some sensitivity to your relationship to the Goldmans.
Yes, he
and
did.
He wanted, I think what you're going to say, because you've written about this, that he wanted the Goldmans
to know that's
that
true.
He was sensitive to their pain.
That's right.
Suffering.
That's exactly right. And I told the Goldmans that. And they were, shall we say, indifferent. They did not say, And I could understand both sides.
But let's not miss the main point here. Barry Sheck, in your judgment, knew O.J. Simpson did the crime.
Well, I believe that. I mean, he did. He has never said such a thing. And I just want to just finish telling you this. 2 days later, he said to me once, after this extraordinary experience we had together, he said, I just want you to know, if you remember that conversation, Dominick, that I totally and completely believe in the innocence of O.J. Simpson. So, you know, that was both sides.
All right, but you were there in the courtroom. You believe Cochran thought Simpson did it?
Yes, I do.
You do?
Yeah.
And his job was to get him off?
Yeah. It was all their job. I mean, that's why you spend all that money.
Because you believe that it was impossible to know anything about the Simpson case and the facts and not believe that he committed the crime.
I believe, yes, primarily because of the DNA. I mean, there's no explanation other than that. There's a lot in this story that still hasn't come out yet. I don't
like
know
what?
If it ever will. Well, you know, one of the most interesting pieces, players in this story is Kardashian. And, Kardashian knows more than what he is telling us.
He's a guy that had the bag with whatever was
he
in it and
bag,
said he
yeah.
never looked in and never wanted to know. And
yeah. See, I don't believe that the bloody clothes were in that bag. What I believe is that when he and OJ went to the Los Angeles airport to pick up the golf bags, that OJ had to leave behind in Chicago, I think the knife was probably in the golf bag. Do you understand? Because it
yeah.
could go through the system, you know, because...
The metal detectors.
Yeah, and I think that probably Kardashian got rid of that.
Got rid of the knife.
Well, I don't know this, but I mean, something... Okay. These guys all know more, as Al Cowlings knows more.
What do you think he knows?
A lot. I mean...
Because O.J. talked to him in
yeah,
that
well,
famous ride.
Yeah.
And because he was best friend. And because
but
he spent time with him proximate to...
To the murder.
The murder.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't know exactly. Somebody had to come in and clean up that house. You know what I mean. Somebody had to... There were things that had to be put away in there.
This is Rockingham.
Yeah. I mean, before, with the he had the limo outside, he had taken a shower... somebody had to get, things had to be gotten rid of.
Do you believe that Furman planted evidence?
I do not.
Do you believe that Vanetta lied at all?
Well, I'll tell you, yes. I mean, I think that when he said that O.J. was not a suspect when he went to the house. I just don't believe
that.
They
all thought.
I mean, I just don't believe that. I mean, you know, in any kind of murder case, when a woman is murdered, the husband, the boyfriend, is always the first person that they suspect. I think that was stupid for them to have. I don't know if that's a lie or not. Well, I guess it is a lie. I mean, you know, and of course they suspected him.
Yeah. The LAPD, without their conduct, and the accusations made by the defense, would the prosecution have prevailed? In other words, did the prosecution have a burden to bear that almost made their case impossible to win?
Well, they did, really. I mean, you know, the work that was done by the, the technicians and so forth who went to gather things, I mean, that was the worst thing I ever saw, and so much of it was on videotape, people walking through the crime scene and not having the proper things. And you know, Van, it's always bothered me about Van Adder carrying that blood in his pocket for all
yeah,
that
that's
time.
Also that's as inexplicable.
I don't care what they say, the thing, if there's something wrong with that. I mean, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That anyone would know that something's going to happen on a hot day to blood in a tube in your pocket.
Especially if you're a 20-year veteran of them. Police work.
Yeah, there's something off there.
Who has had the most honest conversation with Simpson that you know of? I mean, have you met anybody, talked to anybody who feels like they had an honest conversation? Because the defense attorneys have come on this broadcast and say, of all the meetings I've ever had with O.J., there was not a time that he didn't protest his innocence, that he didn't, you know. And it wasn't necessary for them to say that in the context of this conversation.
But someone I know who knows him very, very well.
Knows Simpson.
Yes, indeed. I'm very close terms with him at this moment, said just the other day, if he had to take a lie detector test now, he'd pass it. I just find that fascinating, which means that he has so indoctrinated himself with this story that he is. I find that fascinating.
I do too, but I heard that a long time ago. Norman Mailer told me that Lawrence, whatever his name is,
Schiller,
said either didn't do it or he believes he didn't do it.
Yeah.
That he convinced himself.
Yeah, I think he had. Well, of course he has.
You know, yeah. That he didn't.
Yeah.
Why is he going on television in London on some program called The Tonight Show to answer questions?
It's so desperate. It's so
desperate. For what?
I mean, you know, nothing is working in this man's life. You have to understand it. You know, the video was a big flop.
Didn't make a lot of money. I don't know.
Quite just a little under 30,000 copies, and they say that 10,000 of those were for the media. I mean, that's not a big deal if that's what you're going to pay off your lawyers on. And just nothing is working out in his life. And no matter how many times he goes on TV, and no matter how, he's not convincing anyone anymore that what he is saying is true. It's like the country is on to him, and he must know that now. Now he's going to try it in England for money.
And no one knows what his head says to him about that. I mean, as we watch him be rejected at all the places that he used to.
Well, you see, I think that's what the Al Cowlings is in his life for. I think probably to Al Cowlings, he can say things that he can't say to anyone else, or to Arnell. You know, his daughter is a really nice and lovely young woman. Yeah. And I think...
You think he confides in her honestly?
I'm not sure, but I think they're so close that he might... I mean, it has to hurt him. It has to hurt him that he is being rebuffed. That nobody is there's somebody you got to unload this to.
Some have said it's a worse punishment than being judged guilty for him.
Yeah.
Just to know that everybody knows he's free to walk around. Now, a lot of others who are in prison would say, come on, give me a break.
Yeah.
There's nothing compares to being inside and not having your freedom.
But you see, he isn't like just any prisoner who got off. He has one of the most recognizable faces on earth now. You know, after that, there's nowhere he can go that people aren't going to react and react badly to him.
Menendez brothers,
should
they have been given capital punishment?
No, not to me. I think that this was absolutely right. Life without the possibility of a parole. I happen not to believe in capital in the
death penalty.
I just don't. And I mean, I would never go out and stand outside a prison at night with a candle. I mean, I don't feel that strong, but on the other hand...
Intellectually, philosophically, you're opposed to the state taking life.
Yeah.
But not so opposed you want to, on a cold, windy night, stand outside on behalf of somebody. How are you doing now? You had this terrible thing about your son who you thought was lost, right?
Well, he was lost. He was lost for 5 days. And I left the trial at that time. And I went to see Judge Ito first and explained to him, and I went. And you know, it was that experience which was one of the most horrible experiences of all time. And after
all you've been through?
Yeah, well, I mean, think...
You've been down in the valley.
I know, I've been down in the valley. But to think, I kept thinking, how could this happen to me again? Or not to me, but to us, to my wife, to my kids, and to my sons. And how could this be happening again? And after the fourth day, Charlie, I said to Griffin, my older son, I said, he's dead. He has to be dead. And, but you know, it made me, it made me re-believe in the power of prayer. I cannot tell you the thousands of people who said to me, I prayed for your son. I prayed for you. People I didn't know in the supermarkets of L.A., everybody, every person I ever knew, I never saw anything like it. And that was an amazing experience, and it also made me realize that I was a part of the story of the O.J. trial. Because when I was over there, you know, I heard from Marcia Clark. I heard from Gil Garcetti, the D.A. I heard from I don't know who. Barry Scheck, when I got back, was just... hugged me like this. I mean, it just shows the reverse side of everybody. And, you know, the people outside the trial, when it came to a family and the possibility of losing a child, we all sort of, I don't know what. It was an extraordinary experience for me.
Chris Darden.
I admire him enormously. You know, every day of the trial, you know, Johnny Cochran would say to Judge Ito, Your Honor, this trial is a search for truth.
Who would say that?
Johnny Cochran. He said it every day. Your Honor, this trial is a search for truth. And then he'd go on and tell us that while the murder was taking place, O.J. was chipping golf clubs and the Colombian drug gang over here was killing Nicole because they thought she was Faye Resnick. I mean, it was absurd what he was saying. But Chris Darden was like a beacon of light to me in that trial. He has ethics, and he lost, and he made some terrible mistakes. The glove thing, everything that's so. But as a human being, I think he was the finest person in that room.
Marcia Clark.
Marcia Clark is a very bright, very funny, very good prosecutor, but I think she made a couple of really bad errors. And I think one was during jury selection, when she was advised that African-American women would not respond to domestic violence in the same way that Caucasian women would, and she said in words to the effect, I am a woman, I know what I feel. Well, I mean, she was wrong, and the people who advised her, and I think it was wrong also, and it was a terrible call about Furman, that they put as much, that they made him as prominent, because they had been warned about Furman.
By Darden, among others, hadn't they? Yeah. Quick question, but I want to move on to what's going to be on television this season in Purgatory, based on your book, which we've talked about on this program before. You are writing a novel about this. Mm-hmm. This is a novel, but it's based on a story that took place in Connecticut. Why do it that way?
Well, I tell you, there's things I can tell this way that I would have a hard time telling. I mean, I had some incredible experiences, and it's all going to be very clear who everybody is. Believe me, everybody will know. And but you know, when I say this is like what Truman Capote did with In Cold Blood. That's a factual story written in the style of a novel. And I kind of like that style. And also, you know, I move in so many circles in Los Angeles that, I mean, I'm dealing with just not the trial, but I'm dealing with the obsession of a city during that trial. It was the most fascinating thing I ever saw in my life. And no matter what group or what thing I was in, this was the main topic of, no matter what was happening, and I want to catch all that in this book.
There was this one story that made the rounds about Howard Weitzman, the first attorney.
I'm sure you do.
Nobody in L.A., the consequence you don't know. that he was telling a story about, what was the story that making the rounds of the dinner parties, that he was telling a story that I heard, and that is why,
the story that made the rounds was that Margaret Weitzman, who's a fabulous woman and terrifically outspoken, said, if Howard hadn't given up that case, I would have divorced him.
I see. Because?
You see, they had known O.J. before, because Howard had represented him, do you remember, after one of the 911 calls. And Margaret Weitzman knew Nicole and knew that O.J. had beaten her.
Season of Purgatory.
Yes.
Now, do you have anything to do with the screenplay?
Nothing.
Nothing. You sell the book and it's off and running.
Well, yeah. I mean, I usually have something to do with it. I didn't, because of the O.J. case and my obsession with it, while they were making this, I had nothing to do with it.
All right. Here's a clip from this, A Season of Purgatory, which airs on CBS May 5th and May 7th. Brian Dennehy is in this, and also Patrick Dempsey. Take a look.
It was an accident, Harrison.
It was murder.
And you're an accessory.
It was an accident. Constant is a good boy. He's got a great future. And I'm not forgetting the part that you've played, Harrison. Helping him remain at Whitley Academy. You're a part of him too, Harry. These things pass. People forget. Life goes on.
Winifred Utley's life does not go on. How do you think you can just ignore this?
Indeed, I'm not ignoring it. Within minutes, every scrap of trash connected to this unfortunate accident will be on its way out of here. The cab driver who brought Constant home from the club will become the owner of a fleet of cabs. The Scarborough police will no doubt make their grim discovery soon after dawn. When they come canvassing the homes, they will find us at breakfast with one of their favorite priests, Father Murphy. A kid, Mary Pat, will already be on the early train back to school, but you, Harry, you will be here. And you will tell the police that you saw Constant in bed asleep. You're sure, because you were sharing the same room with him.
Why should I tell them that?
Because rather than go to prison for who knows how long, I will offer you an option more befitting your potential, Harry. Travel anywhere in the world. A free university education anywhere in the world. And my attorney will send you handsome checks monthly.
That's on CBS May 5th and May 7th, a season in Purgatory based on an early book by Dominick Dunne. You're now writing this book that's based, the novel about the Simpson trial and I don't know what else, all the characters and all the stories that you couldn't talk about, you'll be able to talk about in that book. And if there is a great trial somewhere in America, you will be there. There's something about you, especially if it involves the famous.
Yeah.
You're drawn to it because it's...
Yeah, because the rules are different if you're rich and famous, as we have seen, as the world has seen in the O.J. Simpson trial, and that's based on an actual case too,
involving Ethel Kennedy's
nephew.
Yeah. All right. Great to see you as always,
Charlie. Great to see you,
Nick Dunne. We'll be right back. Stay with us. For many Americans, playing the stock market is a frightening experience, better left to financial bigwigs who earn their living off their expertise. But brothers David and Tom Gardner have set out to prove that even fools can beat Wall Streeters at their own game. Their Motley Fool Investment Club provides an open and irreverent forum for public discussion on the information highway. Its success at besting the market has made it one of the most popular stops, and I'm pleased to have these two brothers here, the Motley Fool Investment Guide, How the Fool Beats Wall Street Wise Men and How You Can Too, is their book. Welcome.
Great. Thank you, Charlie.
Thanks for having us.
How did this start for you guys?
Well, we actually investing started because our father gave us a little bit of money when we turned 18.
Right.
And that's really the way it all started. But because so many people don't get any investment education in this country at all. We were fortunate to be given a little and start learning it. But we started The Motley Fool as a printed newsletter and then took it on to America Online about 18 months ago. And it's really changed everything that we've done since.
And how many stops per, day? How do you measure it?
That software is just coming together for America Online. So we're just starting to get demographics. It's really difficult for us to know how many people are coming in per day, but per month now we have 150,000 households.
Yeah. And so, what is it that's important for us to know about this experience?
I think what's really fascinating about it is that it is interactive. Marshall McLuhan wrote that the medium is the message.
Right.
And this particular medium is two-way. It's the first interactive medium. And so people have the opportunity, if they, let's say, read our book and don't understand something, they can come right online and ask us a question. And so there's this incredible conversation that's developed, in this case about the stock market, whether it's about individual stocks or about how to invest in general. We all have questions about our money and how to manage it, but also those of us who love the stock market like to keep up with companies like Sun Microsystems and all the exciting stocks out there. And so that's what's really fascinating about it. It's a discussion.
And people can talk back and forth. And what do you have to bring to engage in this conversation with you guys, though? What is it you have to bring? A curiosity? What?
An interest in better returns on your savings.
Yeah.
We welcome people who don't know anything about investing, who come in and say, I've used a product, I am in the software business, I know a lot about small software companies out here in Seattle, but I don't know anything about investing. They can come in and participate. You have Wall Street analysts that know a lot about the financial side, but they're constantly looking for more information on the product. So there's really room for everyone to come in consumer business is 65% of business in the U.S., so we have the advantage as consumer investors to look around us and see what public companies are offering and get online and talk about it.
And what kinds of companies are you investing in?
Well, we actually have a real mix. Part of our investment approach is mixing very large companies that we all know, companies like General Electric and Chevron and Sears, with small high flyers that many of us don't know. And I won't even bother mentioning the names. But the point is really that you start off with a foundation of solid companies that have posted historically good returns. Then you begin to mix in some more volatile growth stocks, because those often can be your best winners. And in our Motley Fool portfolio, which we offer online, we've put up some great returns over the last 18 months. In fact, we tell people we're not actually this good, but we've done so largely by picking companies that before Wall Street found them.
How did you find them before Wall Street found them?
There's a real mix of ways that we do. Increasingly online, you just see the conversation start up. We can't be in on every conversation now. That we get something like 1,500 notes a day.
Right.
I mean, we say in the book, we're now getting 2 Motley Fool investment guides through our forum every day. That's how much information is flowing through there. So sitting back and looking at some of the conversations, but then we really do look for companies as they announce earnings. Companies have to announce earnings 4 times a year. It's a great time for individuals to look around and say, okay, this company is growing sales by 25% a year, earnings by 25% a year. This is a really rapid growth situation. I might as well call them, get the financials. And now with online, you have this opportunity to say, does anyone know anything about this company? The financials look great, but I don't really know much about the products.
And there's a great example from last year. We bought a stock in a company called iOmega, which makes the Zip Drive, which many reviewers may be familiar with. But it was a wonderful product, and it was out there on the shelves. Well before Wall Street ever found out about it, people started posting notes about it. Said, you know, I called all the 10 computer superstores in my city, and there aren't any there. And in fact, I've counted 177 back orders for it. And then somebody else in another city would say the same thing.
Yeah.
We began to piece it together. Again, it's a national conversation of the sort that was never possible before the technology.
How about emerging markets, though? How do you guys, I mean, with the World Wide Web, you know, does it give you any insight into emerging markets, which seems to be a place that a lot of people want to be?
It could. It could. I mean, I think it presents that opportunity for people that are looking for it. And we do have a discussion of foreign stocks in our area. It's not something that interests us at all. I mean, the U.S. market is
not
is so...
But emerging U.S., like internet stocks.
Oh,
no, no, I'm talking about the world.
Hey, come on.
Yeah, right.
No, you know, the U.S. market is so big, so broad, so well-regulated, that I don't like to get involved. I don't think anyone at our company likes to get involved in stocks where we're going to get the information last.
Yeah, but how do you verify the information you get?
Well, you have to, I mean, in our forum, so much of it is coming through. You really do have to verify it sometimes. You've got to call the company and find out what's going on. But more often than not, what we're finding is you've got an atmosphere. We've created an atmosphere where we set standards and we've said, come in and give us, you know, what you know, and let's build together and figure out what's going on with a variety of smaller cap companies that we could get no information on our own. And people are participating, and it's just feeding on itself. So the coverage, another stock I'll just throw in that we bought that we've sold, is Ride Snowboard, a Seattle snowboard company. Now, that was really a Peter Lynch play for us. We never would have bought a snowboard. Neither of us are snowboarders. But there in our Ride Snowboard folder, kids started coming in and saying, I like this board. I like this board for this reason. Parents came in and said, well, my son's snowboarding on a Ride Snowboard. And I did look at the financials, and they look great. And then, you know, the analysts following the company or the underwriters of the company are coming in and posting notes as well in that folder. So it's an incredible mix it's a motley group of people that are coming online from Wall Street analysts right on down to just consumers that haven't invested before.
What's your fiscal year? When is your fiscal year?
December fiscal year.
Calendar. Yeah. And how much did you make last year? What was sales revenue?
Our company took in just under $1 million last year. Our goal this year is $3 to $5 million. So we remain a very small company.
But how fast do you expect to grow?
Well, I think we can keep up that growth rate for the next few years because there's a tremendous opportunity for publishers using this new technology to get to people quicker. For example, we do an evening news each night recounting what happens on the stock market. It hits our subscribers' desk at 6 p.m. They don't have to wait for the Wall Street Journal the next day. So the quickness of it and just the opportunity to participate.
You also have something that I find intriguing called a fool ratio. Mm-hmm. Tell me what that is.
Sure. It simply takes the percentage of a company's growth rate. So if a company's growing at 40% a year, for example, and it compares it to the price-to-earnings ratio of the company's stock. And without getting into the technicality of it, suffice to say that companies trade, their prices per share trade off of the amount of earnings that they have, a multiple. So
sure.
If your company makes $2 a share last year and your stock's at 40, you're trading at 20 times earnings.
Right.
Now, if on the other hand, your growth rate is 40%, we would compare the 20 to 40 and we'd say your growth rate is much quicker than the market is valuing you. So we look for those situations. And what it often helps us find are companies that are growing like crazy. Let's say some internet companies that are growing 100% or more a year. And we'll see, oh, look, the market has put a multiple, a PE multiple of only about 50 on it. Now, a lot of people think of 50 multiple on earnings is really, really high. But when we, on the other hand, see that the company's growing at triple-digit growth rates, we tend to buy those situations, and that's often where we make our most money.
Okay.
Lynch talked about that, the earnings line on a graph and the stock price move in tandem over the long haul. So if the earnings line on the graph is going up 20% a year, you can expect the stock to go up 20% a year. When that stock price falls behind the earnings growth, you get an opportunity to get in on the cheap when Wall Street either hasn't paid attention to the company or never heard of the company.
And how do you be sure about that earnings growth?
You have to do your own work, and you can obviously follow the work that the Wall Street analysts have done.
In terms of their projection of what the earnings growth will be.
That's right. You have to look at forward growth, not past growth, because, of course, the market's always looking forward, so you need to look forward, too.
All right. The Motley Fool Investment Guide, How the Fool Beats Wall Street's Wise Men, and How You Can, Too. Look at this cover. I mean, this is...
We look better with the hats on.
Yeah, there you are. Thank you very much for
being
here. Thanks
a lot. Thank
you, Charlie.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
By a grant from USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders. To order Charlie Rose program transcripts for $5 each and video cassettes for $29.95 each, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS, or write to Journal Graphics at the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.